The NBA is not actually short for National Gambling Association, but gee, it sure feels like maybe it should be lately. Anthony Davis is gambling by asking for a trade right now. If it gets him to the Lakers, as he seems to want, jackpot. If he doesn't, well, the Pelicans could just wait until the summer to trade him, completely shut him down in the meantime to protect their asset, and he loses half the season of his basketball career, a likely All-NBA spot, and ends up playing somewhere he clearly doesn't want to play. Oh, and remember the last time AD missed out on All-NBA? It cost him a $24 million contract bonus. So all the way around, those are some serious stakes to be risking. But thanks to the Knicks, hey, he's now not even the biggest gambler at the table. Yes, New York shocked the league yesterday by trading away a player with such a rare and precious skill set. His nickname is literally the Unicorn for a package mostly designed to open up the cap space to sign two max salary players this summer. Afterward, the Knicks pushed hard on the narrative that they had to do this, that Kristaps Porzingis didn't want to be in New York anymore. According to team president Steve Mills, KP met with the team yesterday morning and explicitly, quote, confirmed he no longer wanted to be a Knick. Although considering that New York reportedly already had the framework of a deal in place with Dallas before KP even walked through that door, and according to ESPN's Ian Begley, the meeting lasted less than 5 minutes, well, it's probably not a shock that KP posted this on his IG story last night, saying the truth will come out. Look, regardless of the finger pointing that is inevitably coming here, the bottom line is, the Knicks decided that some of the cards they had in their hand, which included a wildly talented but 7'3" human coming back from an ACL tear, were worth discarding for the chance of drawing something even more valuable from the deck, like perhaps, I don't know, maybe a card that is currently playing for Boston. Just yesterday on this show, I said that I believe in the Tooth Fairy and Santa Claus and players who stand up in front of an arena full of 20,000 people and say they're going to re-sign with their team.
Uh-oh.
But then this morning, Kyrie Irving was given the opportunity to tamp down speculation he could indeed be available to be lured to the Knicks this summer. And instead he said, well, take a look at what he said.
Well, at the end of the day, I'm going to do what I feel is best for my career. And, you know, that's just where it stands. And my focus this season is winning the championship with the Boston Celtics. You know, obviously we had goals coming into the season, and primary goal is to win championships, so that's where my focus is.
Has your mindset shifted, though, in regards to re-signing with Boston, like the announcement?
Ask me July 1st.
And did something happen? Did something change?
No, I mean, I'm going to just do what's best for me. That's where it really comes down to. I'm just trying to be a human being, trying to make the best decision for me and my family. So, you know, obviously, you know, things this season haven't gone as I planned. You know, and that's part of being on a team where you're still trying to figure things out. But at the end of the day, like I said, I spent the last 8 years trying to do what everybody else wanted me to do in terms of making my decisions and trying to validate through the media, through other personnel, managers, anybody in this business. And I don't owe anybody, so.
I don't owe anyone bleep. Oh, boy. So should the Celtics now proceed as if Kyrie may not be there next season? Kyrie's contract, remember, is what's holding Boston back from acquiring Anthony Davis right now. Should Danny Ainge push all his chips to the center before next week's trade deadline, work a three-team deal that sends Kyrie elsewhere and brings Davis to Boston before anyone else can grab him? Basically, all of the plans that all of these teams are making right now are, well, a gamble. And the conditions they take into account when they're placing their bets could very easily completely change before those bets even have the chance to pay off. Maybe we should just start calling the NBA the high rollers room. That is certainly what it feels like. Scotty, things change so quickly every 24 hours. I mean, given Kyrie's comments just this morning, should the Celtics start thinking about whether they want to move him before the deadline?
Well, I mean, I think the Celtics has a lot of pieces that they can play with, and Kyrie happened to be their most valuable piece. In terms of, if you want to get an Anthony Davis, obviously they have to move Kyrie if they want to land him. So
yeah, if they want to land
him. I think that, you know, last season really gave the Celtics an opportunity to see what they really had. And Kyrie got injured. The younger players have evolved and came around. I think he is a piece that they could move, but I don't see the Celtics having any success without Kyrie, because I think he's a fourth quarter guy. He's a winner, and he's the guy that has to carry them through the fourth quarter. And I just don't see anyone that can replace him in that position.
Somebody may have to replace him if he's halfway out the door. I agree with everything Scotty said. But the problem now is, if you're Danny Ainge and you don't think he's committed to you, look, Kyrie, he's right. He didn't owe the Celtics or anybody anything.
Yeah.
But the Celtics don't owe him either. This is a two-way business.
Right.
And so the question becomes, okay, can you get part of Anthony Davis's attraction to Boston is playing with Kyrie. Now, if you don't know he's going to be there, and let's face it, we are sitting 3,000 miles away from the frenzied center of news this morning.
You think the frenzied center is now?
This is one of the frenzied centers.
By the way, wait until tonight. When the Celtics play at Madison Square Garden,
well, Rachel, that's
what I'm
saying.
And Kyrie walks on the floor.
Look, everybody today thinks that Kevin Durant and Kyrie Irving, everybody in New York, are both headed there as free agents soon. So now if you're Danny Ainge, at least, first of all, the Lakers just got a bunch of leverage back, okay? Because the Lakers can now say to, you know,
to Dell Demps
in New Orleans, I'm sorry, you're going to trade him there? Is he going to stay there? What's in operation? What's in play here? Does the player that you're accommodating to some degree want to be there? So there's so many balls in the air, Scotty. Yes. I agree with you that Boston's best bet looks like to try to win with Kyrie.
Yes.
But that may be this season. How do we know what's going to be in play after that?
And by the way, I mean, this is a good peeling back of the layers of how sort of the inner workings of the NBA work at this time of year. So there was definitely some murmuring over the past couple days of, hey, maybe Kyrie's not staying. And the feeling was that, hey, that's just being put out by Anthony Davis's camp. Because as you point out, if Boston is not keeping Kyrie Irving,
right,
they are not offering to trade away as many of their assets for AD. They need Jason Tatum. They need some of those guys. So the idea behind the scenes would be that if you feel like, hey, Danny Ainge, he might be telling you now, just wait till the summer, I'll give you Jason Tatum, I'll give you a whole boatload. But you better wait, because if Kyrie doesn't stay, he's going to come back to you in June and say, forget it. Well, Kyrie had the chance to shut the door to all of that
and help
Boston.
Opened it wider.